There's really nothing more amazing than the human body. The fact that that there are some who believe that it just happened out of nothing. Well, it would take a lot of imagination to believe that all this could come together and function like it functions in the proper order to meet absolutely every need that we have inside on its own. I'm thankful that God gives us what we need when we need it. I'm grateful that God is greater than the laws of nature, greater than all the things of this world, that there is nothing impossible to our God. We have so many things to be thankful for. We usually think about Thanksgiving as a time we come together and have a lot of good food to eat, probably a whole lot more food than what we need. And during that day, the family gatherings and the football games, and maybe we will take a little short time, maybe, where everybody tells what they're thankful for, and we should. The commercialism of Thanksgiving has grown and grown and grown so much to the place that a lot of stores are opening up for Black Friday on Thursday, Thanksgiving Day. You say, well, that's not bad. It's not bad within itself, except that it takes employees away from their families and away from a day set aside for Thanksgiving. I noticed on Yahoo this morning, one of the big headlines is that employees are told that they will be fired if they don't show up for work on Thursday, on Thanksgiving Day. And through the story, it was one of the retail chains that said that they would fire anyone who didn't show up on Thanksgiving Day to work. We've gone a long way from the foundation of our nation. A long way from where we started from, a long way from the place where our nation was built. Our government was settled, it was started, it was organized by men who believed that God was in control, by men who publicly declared that God, we needed God to come together to survive in His direction, to make the kind of nation that they were seeking. When you think of Thanksgiving, usually we think about the pilgrims, or at least we used to. By the way, history is being rewritten again, or trying to be rewritten again, and the truth being taken out of it. Within the new Common Core curriculum, when it comes to the pilgrims, there's just a very, very brief segment on it that says that pilgrims were terrorists who came to America and terrorized those living here. Then it goes on to another subject. That's not true. It's not true at all. As a matter of fact, history is very clear, and it is highly documented, the steps that the pilgrims took. If you go back far enough, you will see that the pilgrims began over in England, actually before that time. They were seeking for freedom to worship. Now, over in England, King James, rather, when he came to the throne, he had the Bible translated into English. Nearly every historian you read says that the reason he had it translated into English was to thumb his nose at the Catholic Church, because the Catholic Church had gotten on to him about his divorce and remarriage many times. So he did that in defiance of the Catholic Church. So he then found it necessary to organize a church outside the framework of the Catholic Church, because he was no longer recognized in the Catholic Church. So they created the Church of England. Now, the Church of England, it used the Bible, and it went back to the Bible and used a lot of precepts that the Catholic Church taught at the time. But there was one difference, that the Pope over the Church of England was the king. And that whatever the king said, that was law. However the king interpreted the Bible, that's the way that the nation was to see it, and the way the nation was to follow. There were a group of people who genuinely believed in the Word of God, genuinely believed that God was the authority, who believed that it was right to worship Almighty God. And because of their belief and their outspokenness about God as their authority and not the king and not the government, many of them lost their jobs. A great many of them lost what property that they had. Many of them, their lives had been threatened. This went on for a long period of time, but they still remained faithful, and they still remained outspoken about their love of God and their devotion of God. over a period of time, they decided that the only hope for them was to get out of England, and so they left on some boats, and only to have someone turn them in, and the boats were turned around, and a bunch of them had to spend a long time in prison for that, trying to get out of the nation in order to worship freely. Over a period of time, they did, and went through several different countries, and to make a long story short, that's what brought the pilgrims to America. Now, when the pilgrims came to America, it was that they came for the purpose of having freedom to worship God. As a matter of fact, there are several of the pilgrims' memoirs that are still available. Some of them are pretty segmented. Only certain parts of them you can still find available. But in their memoirs, they all come to nearly one conclusion. Now, we always think about the Mayflower, but there was another boat when they left coming to America, the Stillwater. And the Stillwater, when they first started out, it began to take on water, so they had to turn around and go back to shore. Then they fixed what they thought the leak was, and they started again. And it started to take on water and started to sink again. They had to turn around and go back to shore the second time. So they came to the conclusion that what they were going to have to do is everybody get on the Mayflower and begin to come this direction. So 105 passengers and 30 crewmen crowded on board the ship, and they started towards America. They came to America after having gone through a series of difficulties and a series of storms. And when they got to America, it was that they had to stay on board the boat for another month while a group of people went out and explored the land trying to find just the right place for a settlement. Now, while they were gone, William Bradford, probably remember William Bradford from time in history, back when they still talked about William Bradford in history, but William Bradford was the first governor of the Plymouth Colony, of the new colony here in the United States. He was one of the expedition that went out. So as he went out and was gone for an entire month with his group of people trying to find just the right place to live, when he came back to the ship, he found out that his wife somehow lost her footing and fell overboard and drowned in the water. They had lost a child coming across the sea, and then now William Bradford's wife had fallen overboard and down into the sea. So they all left the ship after a month, and they went to this place that they had discovered. And there they begin to work building the structures to live in, because the winter was coming real, real fast. During the time in coming in, there was a great illness that fell upon the people. Matter of fact, the illness was so great that nearly everybody got it. William Bradford was lucky he did not get the illness. Miles Standish, you may remember another name from history. Miles Standish was a soldier, and he was in charge of protecting the people there in the colony. Now, Miles Standish's wife, Rose, got the illness as well. Matter of fact, when the illness was so severe, when they got through, there were 18 wives in this group of people. And after the illness was over, there were only 5 wives still living. That left a whole lot of homeless children and a whole lot of husbands without their wives. But anyway, Miles Standish, in the time that they were coming, they didn't have time to grieve, and they didn't have time to stop and to wonder why all this was happening. What they did was, when they got to the place of being a colony, it was that William Bradford said, "All right, guys, we need to stop, and the first thing we need to do is to thank God for allowing us to get to shore." His wife had just drowned on board the ship, but he said, "The first thing we need to do is we need to stop, and we need to thank God." So many times, most of us would have stopped and begin to look at the situation and begin to look at things around us and question God, rather than realizing that God has a purpose and God is at work even in the things that hurt so deeply to us, because that's the nature of God. God has a purpose and God has a plan, and God works through His purpose and through His plan for our good. So William Bradford called for a time of thanksgiving. Then they begin to go out, and people like Miles Standish, who had to go out and cut wood and had to go out and prepare food, and then had to take care of his wife as well through all this, besides protecting the colony. They all had to work as hard as they possibly could all day long just to survive. They came through this winter, or are coming to the winter. There were a group of some 91 Indians, some Native Americans who came, and they were afraid of them right at first. They thought this was something dreadful coming to take their lives away. But what they found were these 91 Indians came and became very good friends. They became very, very helpful in planning and making sure that they had food together and helping them to survive in this strange land altogether. It was that God took this that they thought was a curse and he made a blessing to it. So many times in life when we look at it, when we look at the situations and we say nothing good can possibly come from this. But God has a plan, and God has a purpose, and God is working his plan, and God is working his purpose. They came through this terrible, terrible winter. There were many, many who were lost to the illnesses. Many who did not survive the cold, hard winter. But those who came through the next summer, they had a bountiful crop. I mean, everything was really good. The rains came just exactly right. The weather was just exactly right. Everything was what it needed to be, so that the crops, they had all that they could possibly eat and put aside so that they'd have enough to get them through the next winter. So what was the first thing they did? Bradford said, okay, guys, it's time that we have to look at that. It's time for us to give thanks to God. So he said, so he called for the people to come together and have a feast to thank God for what he had given. Historians have taken a little bit, there's several copies of his memoirs, and parts of each one are gone, but they've taken little bits of it, put it together to give us a copy of what Bradford wrote to that first group about coming through and having survived. He said, "This now nigh a year since we landed, and ye cold winter took a number of ye friends away, but ye spring and summer have been goodly ones. Ye Indians have been friends to us. Look around, kind brethren, and see ye the bounteous crops of the year. Ye goodly Lord have given us these with your bounteous rain and sun. Look far away into the forest and see those savages so rude and cruel. Ye gracious Lord hath given us power to make friends with those who might have been, methinkest, our bitterest enemies. God hath bestowed upon us many rich blessings, as he did to the Israelites when he delivered them from the land of darkness. In your scriptures it is written, when thou hast eaten and are full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land for which thou hast given me. Methinks it meet for me to appoint a day for a purpose of offering our thanks to you, God, who pour such great riches upon us." Their trials were very, very far from being over. 2 years later, there was such a severe drought that nothing was surviving, that it looked like there was sure demise for this group of people. They still did not complain. What they did is that they accepted this as God's purpose for them, and that there was a reason that was coming because of the drought that they were facing. Edward Winslow, one of the colonists, said he had lost his wife during the first winter as well. He said, "It pleased God for our further chastisement to see the great droughts, in so much as in 6 weeks there barely fell any rain. Both blade and stalk were hanging their heads and changing their color in such manner as we judged them utterly dead. The crops began to shrivel up as though they had been scorched with a fire." it's interesting how he begins. He says it pleased God for further chastisement. Now, the word chastisement, we usually take to mean discipline, and it is in a sense discipline. But what it actually is, it is training instruction. It is that the consequences are how God trains us so that we don't repeat mistakes, so that we improve ourselves, so that we head in the direction that He wants us to go, or we focus in the things that He wants us to go. So what Winslow said is, it pleased God for us to be channeled to Him. You see, sometimes it takes the drought to really appreciate the rain, right? Sometimes it takes those days or those years or those parts of life when it seems like things just don't fall together to really appreciate the times that it does come together. But in all things, when things come together and when things fall apart, it is that God is always with us and God always provides, right? Have you ever been in a situation when it looked like there was absolutely no hope? It looked like there wasn't money to pay the bills. It looked like there wasn't food to put on the table. Or it looked like there just wasn't a way to continue on. And all of a sudden, something out of the blue, something unexpected in ways that you just couldn't have imagined before, just fell in place. It just came into being. It was just there to provide exactly what you needed at the time that you needed it. Never will forget one time when I was pastor down in St. Augustine that I was, we were, the month had stretched out a lot longer than the paycheck that particular month, and I needed $100 to pay a bill. I can't remember what bill it was, but it doesn't matter. But anyway, I needed $100 to pay a bill. And I didn't say anything to anybody about it. But I was up in town one day walking around the square, and a guy came up to me that I knew. He wasn't a member of our church. He didn't go to our church. His mother loved our church. And he came by and he saw me. He walked up to me and said, "Brother David, you're just too high head on my mind. So I just want to tell you how much I appreciate it." And he put his hand in his pocket and he came out and he started to leave. And he stuck his hand out to shake hands with me. And when he did, he stuck a $100 bill in my hand and walked on the other way. Just exactly what I needed to pay that bill. Now, I'm not telling you that because we just pray for God to give us particular amount. I'm just telling you that sometimes when it looks like there's not any way out, God is always there, isn't He? And He always provides and gives us what we need, because that's the nature of times, those difficult times, to bring us to a place where we really appreciate the nature of God and all that God is doing. Well, it was a blessing that God sends chastisement for our instruction, so that we could be drawn more like Him and closer to His will. Governor Bradford called for a solemn assembly because of the extreme drought. Everything was dying. In this solemn assembly, he asked everybody to meet together. And as they met together, he called for everyone to repent of their sins, for everyone to start fasting and praying. And God answered their prayers. Winslow went on to say, he said, "In the morning when we assembled together," talking about the solemn assembly, "the heavens were clear and drought was likely to continue as ever. But in the late afternoon, after 8 or 9 hours of prayer, the weather was overcast, the clouds began to gather on all sides. The next morning brought soft, sweet throes of rain, continuing for some 14 days. The needed rain was mixed with seasonal weather, as it was hard to say whether our weathered corn or drooping affections were most quickly revived. Such was the bounty and goodness of our Lord. Their attitude was before God, in the rain or in the drought, they knew that they needed God. When it was good, when it was bad, when it was easy, whenever it was difficult, they knew that they need God." And I want to tell you something, folks, today, we all need God, right? I mean, we need Him every day and everything. We are a spoiled generation. We have more than any other generation that's coming on before us, and we're not satisfied. We are a spoiled generation filled with arrogance and pride before Almighty God. And it's time to stop and we say we give thanks, and we say the words of thanksgiving, I'm thankful for this, I'm thankful for that. But in reality, we're thankful when God gives us something we want, when it's something that feels good, or when it's something that we can add to our collection. But we fail to see God or thanksgiving in life every day. We fail to see, even in the most difficult times, we have things to be thankful for, and how God is working and what God is doing.
Well, the pilgrims again just declare the feast for the purpose of giving thanks to God.
Well, the Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Thessalonica, he said, let me tell you something about giving thanks. Let me tell you something about gratitude and the will of God. He says that God has an absolute plan for every one of His children to give thanks. And this is His plan. Rejoice always. Not an easy thing to do, is it? As a matter of fact, human nature is that we complain even when things are good. Things are good, we look around and see the things we don't have and want to complain and want to compare. Well, they got it, why don't we have it? Well, they were allowed this, why can't we have the same thing? It is, he says, that wherever you are, in the midst of difficulties, in the midst of blessing, in the midst of wherever you are, stop and rejoice, because God's in control, God has a plan, and God is going to take care of us no matter what we are facing. Then he goes on to say, and pray without ceasing. Not praying just for stuff, although there's nothing wrong with praying for what we need, nothing wrong with sharing the burdens on our heart or what we're thinking or what's coming across. But in understanding that what we are praying for, that we need to couple that with the fact that, and God, your God, you know better than what I know. So, Lord, whatever you see to be best for me, that's what I am seeking. Now, that's a hard prayer to pray when we're looking for something specific. God, you know better than I know. Pride doesn't want us to say that. But Paul says this is God's will. He says that you rejoice always and that you pray without seeking, always seeking God's direction, always seeking His face, and always following as He leads in our heart. And then he goes on to say, in everything, give thanks. Just like the pilgrims did. When it was tough, I mean when they lost loved ones, when it was so rough that they continued day and night working just as hard as they possibly can, when it looked like the end was in sight, they stopped and gave thanks to God. They stopped and considered God as their direction and God as their leader. Even in the founding of our nation as it came together as a nation, when George Washington led that right after he was inaugurated, he led that group of people from the place of inauguration down the street to that little chapel there that sits right at the edge of Ground Zero. And inside the chapel, he led the new Congress and the Vice President. He led them all in the altar on his knees in prayer, seeking God's direction and wisdom for him to lead the nation, and the understanding to bring just the documents together that would form our laws that were perfect and God wanted us to do. All through the founding of our nation, all through the miracles that were formed. You read George Washington's diary, and he talks about through the war, how it was that he was on his horse, and as he was standing there, they were shooting at him, and it's sure death. And he talks about seeing bullets fly and come right for him and go around him. He talks about the hand of Almighty God, and the only reason he came through safe through the war was because of the hand of Almighty God. So the point is this. If we are really thankful, we can give thanks for the hurts and for the difficult times, as well as giving thanks for the good times and when things seemingly are going just exactly like we wanted to. Why? Because this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for us. If you want to learn how to live a sense of satisfaction and a sense of peace in your heart, regardless of what you face, in other words, that your joy is not dependent upon
the blood are dependent upon things and dependent upon people and dependent upon situation, but the joy is an eternal spring in your heart. If you want to be able to come to a place where that sense of peace and joy is yours, regardless of circumstances and regardless of people, you come to a place where you can, in everything, give thanks. Because this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for each and every one of us. Now, the story of the pilgrims was a true story. It actually happened. We can't imagine the depths of pain. We can't imagine the depths of hardship, such as we probably never faced anything close to before. But they understood this passage of Scripture. They understood that in everything, to give thanks because God is in control. We got that same promise today. We can come to the place where we learn to give thanks in everything, in part, even if it doesn't feel good, even if it's not what we want, and realize that God is in control. There's a sense of peace that passeth all understanding, that comes to know. I don't understand this. I don't know what I'm facing. But God's in control, and He's going to take care of it. And however He takes care of it, it's right. Because He's God. And that's the only thing that He does. He takes care of it right. Because He has a plan, and He's working His plan for you and I. What I'd like for you to do this morning is just search your heart for the things that you really have to be thankful for. I don't mean for that new car, though you may be thankful for that new car, that fast folder, that motorcycle, or all the stuff you've got and all the toys you've been able to accumulate. I'm talking about for the breath of life, for a leg to have arthritis in, for that ability to be able to get up and put one foot in front of the other, even though it may hurt to put those feet down. That for all that you have and all the ways that God has blessed you, for a refrigerator with enough food in it to get you through the evening and through the morning tomorrow, and for a job to go to or a car to drive to the job, and all the things, instead of looking at the things that we don't have and asking why, look at the things that God has blessed us with and say, thank you, Lord. I don't deserve your blessings. I don't deserve all that you have given to us, but you loved us anyway. Would you stand? If I can come and lead us to the verse of invitation. If God is speaking in your heart.